Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Bari'il Khalaikil Ajma'in Ba'ithil Anbiya'i Wal Mursaleen Thumma Assalatu Wassalamu Ala Ashrafil Anbiya' Habib Qulubina Wa Shafi'i Dhunubina Abil Qasim Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. ثم الصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين لا سيما ولي الله الحجة ابن الحسن صاحب الأمر والزمان اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من الأولين والآخرين إلى قيام يوم الدين صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب الغرباء يا مظلوم كربلاء السلام على من جعل الله الشفاء في تربته السلام على من الإجابة تحت قبته السلام على ساكن كربلاء فيا ليتنا ثم يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي يا سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أما بعد قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه الحكيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وجعلناهم أئمة يهدون بأمرنا وأوحينا إليهم فعل الخيرات وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة وكانوا لنا عابدين صدق الله العلي العظيم وآمنا به نوروا مجالسكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. In this verse that we have quoted from Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a single verse, explains to us the responsibility of an imam, and at the same time, he shows for us those characteristics through which we are able to recognize an imam. For you find in Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً And we have appointed them to be imams. Number one, the imam, ma'soom imam, is appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we have established a number of times through a number of dimensions over the last few nights. Number one, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً The imams, a'immah, plural of imam, The imams are appointed, number one, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, وَيَحْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. They guide, يعني the rest of mankind. They guide the rest of the creation. They guide the rest of the people. بِأَمْرِنَا. As per the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For you find that there is a direct link between the imam and the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that they do not guide to the people to any other thing other than the command of Allah. Whatever they preach is a resemblance of the command of Allah and not a product of opinion or speculation. For the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَحْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. We appointed them, selected them as imams who guide you, mankind, through our command. وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ. And we inspired them. Wahi, there are a number of different types of wahi that may be received. There is a category of wahi which is particular to the Anbiya. And then there are other forms of inspirations that even non-prophets are able to receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Quran is proof for this, but perhaps this is a discussion for another night. For they receive inspiration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to perform good deeds, manifestation of goodness in its entirety. What else? Wa ikama salat, to establish the prayer. And we analyzed this concept of ikamatu salat a couple of nights back in a bit of depth. Ikamatu salat wa ita'a zakat wa kanu lana abidin. We commanded the imams in addition to establish the salat, to also establish the institution of zakat. For you find that the central role of the imam, in addition to establishing the prayer, is establishing the concept of zakat. And you will find that the issue of establishing zakat is not only particular to the a'immah or to the prophet in Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. La, you find that giving zakat or establishing zakat was a major responsibility and a central part of tabligh for all the other anbiya that came before Rasulullah. Therefore, by example, you look into Surah Al-Maryam, when Nabi Isa alayhi salam is born and Lady Maryam brings him in her arms, and he is a baby, an infant, newly born infant. He speaks from the cradle and he says, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ وَأَوْسَانِ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا. Nabi Isa speaks from the cradle. The fact that he's speaking from a cradle is a miracle on its own. But then he summarizes his message to the entire Bani Israel. وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ. I am a source of barakah regardless of where I am. And I've been sent for what? وَأَوْسَانِي. Who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent me for what purpose? وَأَوْسَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا. My risalah as a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is summarized in these two aspects: to establish the prayer and to establish the zakat. For you find that zakat is, as a concept, is becoming something central. Nabi Isa, Nabi from the Ulul Azam, similarly with Isa, Musa, Ibrahim, Nuh, Yusuf, Yaqub. If you were to look into their risalas, you find that commanding and establishing the institution of zakat was a central part of their risala. And then you come into the Quran, you find that the issue or the subject of zakat is discussed almost 61 times within the Quran. Subhanallah. And then you come into the life of the Holy Prophet and you look at the seerah of Rasulullah. And you look at the importance that he paid when it came to establishing the institution of zakat. Hadith which is narrated by Imam Muhammad al-Baqir salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He narrates an incident where the Prophet of Islam was in the mosque, Masjid al-Nabawi. And then he gathers the companions, five companions, one after the other. Fulan, kum, falan, kum, falan, kum. You stand up, you stand up, you stand up, until he counted five people. And then Rasulullah says to them, Ukhruju min masajidina. Ajeeb. Rasulullah, rahmatullahi alwasi'a, wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alamin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Rasulullah as being a mercy towards mankind, mercy towards the entire creation. This Nabi, who is an embodiment of the mercy of Allah, is removing five people from the mosque. What crime did they perform? Rasulullah says, تُسَلُّونَ فِيهِ. You recited your salat in the mosque. وَلَا تُزَكُّونَ أَمْوَالَكُمْ. You recite salat, but you don't give zakat. Go out of the mosque. For a Nabi who is a manifestation of mercy to utter this and to take a step such as this shows us at the very minimum the importance and the magnitude of the concept of zakat. And in another hadith, to emphasize the importance of zakat, apart from the fact that every Nabi invited us, or part of the message of every Nabi was to establish the institution of zakat, the jobs of each and every one of the a'immah is to establish the zakat. Zakat in the Quran is mentioned 61 times. In addition to that, Rasulullah kicked out five people from the masjid because they used to pray but never used to pay zakat. More than that, Rasulullah declares in a hadith, Mal'un, mal'un, malun la yuzakka. Cursed, without barakah, without any sort of goodness, is that wealth from which zakat is not being given. For we understand that zakat is an issue, is a zakat of great magnitude and high importance. Having said this, it is important for us to understand what zakat means, in that it is becoming a rampant issue within our community. And when I say within our community, not respected individuals like yourselves, the residents of Atlanta, la, I'm saying generally within the Muslim Ummah, this mentality is starting to take a lot of momentum, where people from within, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, will come and say, well, zakat is given so much importance in the Quran, so much importance within the hadith, but the Shia never pay any sort of zakat except for the zakatul fitrah that comes once a year at the end of Shahru Ramadan. And then they go on to say, subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned zakat so many times in the Quran, why is it that we neglect the zakat and we pay more importance on khums? Each and every person pays importance on khums. Allah didn't mention khums in the Quran. This is what they say. And then they say, but Allah mentioned zakat. So they go on to use this excuse to then say that our current system of fiqh is outdated and needs to be improved. This term, which is generally used, evolution of the religion. In any case, so there's this ishkal that comes up where the people say, that why are we paying so much importance on khums and no importance on zakat, when zakat is mentioned so many times within the Quran, and we've just seen how many hadith and how many concepts talk about the importance of zakat. So why is it zakat is not given importance and khums is given importance? Number two, does khums have any validity or legality within the Quran and the hadith, or is this something that was started by the Shia? This is something that needs to be understood. And then you have another group of people who come and say, yes, khums is within the Quran, khums is a wajib, but khums was restricted to those gains of war and is not necessarily applicable on the profit which we earn from our incomes or from our savings. Therefore, we shall try to counter all these misconceptions that have come in within the lecture and the time that we have today, insha'Allah. But all this before with the barakat of a salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. In addition to all this, before we start, you find that even one of the values for which Imam al-Hussein spilled his blood on the day of Ashura was the establishment of Zakat. As we said a few nights back in Ziyanat al-Waritha, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Ashhadu annaka akamta as-salat wa ataita az-zakat wa amarta bil-ma'ruf wa nahaita anil-munkar. We talked about Salat. So today we will also understand the revolution of Imam al-Hussein and what is the meaning that you gave Zakat or established the Zakat, and also answer all these misconceptions, insha'Allah. See, generally, majority of the times, misconceptions within our religion in regards to issues of Usuluddin or Furuuddin emanate due to a lack of understanding of the definition of that term to begin with. Majority of the times, we are ignorant about concepts, or we have misconceptions about certain concepts because we don't even know what that concept means to begin with. We don't even know the definition of that concept. Therefore, you will find even within the books of mantik, the books of logic, which are traditionally taught within the houses and outside the houses, you will find that within the science of logic, one of the preliminary beginning chapters of logic is that a student is taught the art of formulating definitions. Because in order to understand a concept, you must be able to define it. Once you have defined that concept, you can then understand it and explore all the other dimensions that are attached to it. Therefore, we begin with the definition of Zakat. What is the definition of Zakat as per the Quranic terms and its Quranic usage? When we want to define Zakat as a concept, as a starting point to understand this concept, we use two avenues. Number one, the linguistic meaning of Zakat. What does the word Zakat mean within the Arabic language? And number two, what is the definition of Zakat from a fiqhi perspective? Because this has to do with our deen. It is from the Furu'ud deen and has to do with the fiqh. So we begin by analyzing the definition of Zakat from these two perspectives. Linguistically speaking, you refer back to all the lexicons, you will find that the meaning of Zakat is Tahara. Zakat in Arabic language means Tahara, purification. This is number one. Number two, the word Zakat means Numu, growth. Numuwa, to grow, to expand. We shall leave the dimension of expansion for now, because if we add this within our building blocks, the scope of the language will be beyond perhaps an hour and a half. So for this, we will leave for now. To drive the point home, one of the meanings of the word Zakat is what? Tahara. Therefore, if you hear the word Zakat, linguistically speaking, it means purification. This is from a linguistic perspective. When you come to the Sharia, from a fiqhi perspective, what is the definition of fiqh? In Mawsu'at al-Fiqhiyya by Sayyid al-Mujaddid, he defines fiqh to be haqqun ma'loom thubutuhu fil Qur'an wa sunnah. Zakat is a defined right within the Islam, within the religion, whose validity is established through the Quran and through the Sunnah. Therefore, when you put these two definitions together, what we understand is that Zakat is a generic term. This is important, generic. Zakat is a generic term which is used to describe spending wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Insha'Allah, we are all together so far. Zakat, in its definition, is an amount or a right, a certain amount of money, as per a certain, or a certain amount of wealth, as per a certain percentage. Hakkun ma'lum, it is established, it has a separate or it has an appointed apportion. A certain amount or apportioned amount of wealth which is to be spent in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Generic term for this. Tayyib, if you understand this, then we come to understand that spending wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is divided into two categories. One category is wajib and one category is mustahab. From the categories of spending wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is wajib, we have a number of subcategories. Within the categories of spending wealth in the way of Allah, which is wajib, one category is zakat on agricultural products and livestock, which is known as zakatul mal within the Risala Amaliya. This is a particular amount of tax that needs to be paid on livestock, for example, such as sheep, cow, camel, or on agricultural products such as wheat, barley, dates, and the certain amounts which are designated for the quantities. You can find these within the books of fiqh. This, which is known as zakatul mal generally, the zakat which is to be paid on agricultural crops and on livestock. This is one type of obligatory zakat, as in it is one category of those obligatory spending in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another category that comes under this is kafarat. The kafara that you need to pay, for example, as a penalty for certain violations that we may commit, for example, during Hajj, or for certain violations that we commit during Shahr Ramadan. A third type of obligatory spending in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is nadhar, that I made a vow or I made a covenant for some reason that if this happens and it is fulfilled, for example, I shall give this amount of money or give this amount of my wealth. It becomes wajib upon the fulfillment of the covenant. And then you find the fifth type of spending, which is wajib, is khums. An establishment of khums we will leave for the end of the lecture. For therefore you find that zakat as a generic term, which means spending wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, includes five subcategories under the qism wajib, under the categorization wajib. Zakat on agricultural products and on livestock, nadhar, kafara, and you have the khums. Tayyib. And then in addition to all this, you will find that this zakat, which you pay on livestock and on agricultural goods, within the Quran, it is given another name. It is known as sadaqat. So now you understand that in particular verses of the Quran, sadaqa is a synonym for zakat on livestock and zakat on agricultural goods. The proof for this is within the Quran itself, Surah At-Tawbah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, verse number 60. Innama sadaqatu lil fuqara wal masakin wal amilina alayha wal mu'allafati kulubuhum wa fir rikabi wal gharimina wa fi sabilillah وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ فَرِيذَةً مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. Indeed, the spending of the sadaqat, now that you gave your zakat, how is this zakat supposed to be used? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to zakat over here as sadaqah. So you will find that the art of doing tafsir of the Quran and the science of extracting a hukum shar'i from the Quran is that you are absolutely familiar with the words and the terminologies within the Quran, and to know when certain words are synonyms for others and when they are not. Sometimes the word sadaqah is used to reflect zakat on livestock and crop. Sometimes sadaqah is used to denote general charity, which you and I give. Therefore, you get a glimpse, a very tiny glimpse of the complexities behind extracting a hukum shar'i. The job of the marja or the job of the mujtahid is not one that each and every person who is not qualified can take upon. Unfortunately, we have this within our community. Again, when I say this, not here, but in general, in that each and every other second person has opinions of the religion like he's a mujtahid. Anyway, Allah says in this verse that indeed the sadaqat, yani the sadaqah, yani zakat on livestock and crops, and this is zakat which includes zakatul fitra as well. It's termed as sadaqat. Where is it to be spent? Number one, on the fuqara, on the fakir. Number two, on the miskeen. And there is a difference between fakir and miskeen. This you can find in the books of fiqh. It is to be spent on the poor people. Wal amilin. It is a source of income for those tax collectors employed under the government of the ma'soom imam or under the marja'iyya. Number three, wal mu'allafati kulubuhum. It can be used as a means to reduce the amount of enmity from those people who hold enmity against us. وَفِي الرِّكَابِ وَالْغَارِمِينَ. For those people who are indulged in debt, submerged in debt. وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, in the way of Allah. وَإِبْنِ السَّبِيلِ. Those people who are traveling and, for example, they are stuck in their travel. So therefore, our point over here is what? That sometimes the word sadaqah is used as a synonym for zakat. Therefore, you find that a single term has multiple usage. So far, what we have established is that zakat as a concept within the Quran is a generic term which is used to denote spending wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes the spending of this wealth is wajib and sometimes it is mustahab. Under the acts that are wajib, you have zakat of the livestock and zakat of the crops, you have zakatul fitra, you have khums, you have kafara, and you have nadar. So to drive the point home with an example, this, when we use the word generic, zakat, spending in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's like understanding the concept of tax. You have tax. The definition of tax is what? Tax is an amount of money that you need to pay from your income or from your wealth towards the government. This is a generic term, tax. And then under the bracket of tax, you have different types of taxes. You have income tax, you have sales tax, you have land tax, you have inheritance tax, all different categories that come under a generic term called tax. Similarly, when you come to zakat, it's a generic term, and underneath that you have all those wajib acts of spending in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, certain quantity and certain rules that are governing it, which is found within the books of fiqh. If we understand this, you find that the second category of zakat is mustahab spendings, which is not defined by a certain type of time in the year, which is not designated with a certain proportion, like khums 20%, and zakat a certain percentage on the crops or the sheep or livestock that is there. La. You find that the mustahab is undefined, unrestricted, voluntary spending of wealth in the way of Allah. This includes hadiyah, to give a gift to somebody that you love, to spend money from your wealth and to give a gift to your fellow mu'min brother. This can be one, hadiyah. Number two, kardhul hasana, to give a loan which is interest-free to a brother who may be struggling in opening up a business or becoming dependent in issues of his economical or financial life, to give him a loan without imposing upon him an interest out of goodwill, kardhul hasana, also known as zakat. To give gifts is also known as zakat. Why? Because it comes under the general category, spending in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, under the second subdivision, which is mustahab. So you find kardhul hasana, hadiyah comes under that, and the same time sadaqah, Now we find this sadaqah is different from the sadaqah which is mentioned inside the Quran. This sadaqah, charity. There is a difference between gift and charity. Gift you can give to somebody who is not needy. Gift can be used, for example, to initiate silatul rahim. You have not spoken to a family member or a relative because of an old issue that happened, for example, 20, 30 years ago. You don't know how to break the ice. You don't know how to approach him. You find that the Quran or the Hadith will tell you, no, a good icebreaker is that you buy them a gift and reignite silatul rahim with this gift. It's a token of love, token of forgiveness, token of acceptance to reach out. So therefore, you find hadiyah, the difference between hadiyah and sadaqah is what? Charity. Hadiyah you can give to a person who is not needy. But sadaqah or charity, you give to somebody who is needy, somebody who is struggling. And it is different from kardul hasana, because kardul hasana, once the person is on his feet, he returns the money back to you. But sadaqah or charity that you give, you don't return anything, you don't expect anything back in return. For you find under the mustahab category of zakat, you have a number of categories, mashallah. To give kardul hasana, to give hadiyah, to give charity, to give or to spend money in any amal khair, to build a madrasa, to build a well such that people may benefit water from it. Anything that you spend in the goodwill or for the benefit of the wider community is known as amal khair. Since we are on this topic, between the brackets, the importance of sadaqah. Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He states in a hadith which is mentioned in Kitabul Kafi, he says, Dawu mardakum bis sadaqah. He says, seek the cure of your sick ones, those who are sick around you, your family members or your friends, cure them through sadaqah. For you find that sadaqah is that type of action when you spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is a form of protection for your health, for yourself and for your children. You find that you are struggling with a particular sickness, and in addition to the medication that you take, the Imam says, give sadaqah. You find that it shall protect you from every type of defect or every type of bala in regards to your health. This is in regards to the importance of sadaqah. For you find that so far we have established that zakat as a generic term constitutes of spending wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is divided then into two categories, wajib and mustahab. Within the wajib, you have a number of categories. Within the mustahab, you have a number of categories. Having said all this, you find that it becomes important for us to understand the philosophy behind zakat, spending in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislate the institution of zakat in its generic term, which constitutes of all the wajib subdivisions and mustahab subdivisions? What is the wisdom behind it? Number one, the first philosophy behind giving or establishing the zakat, giving people, other people from your wealth, is that it cleans the heart from hubbud dunya and hubbul mal. We understand this from the khutbah fadakiyya of Sayyidati Nisa al-Alameen, when she explains the philosophy of the ahkam and she begins to explain why zakat has been ordained. She says, "Wa zakat tazkiyatan linnafs." Allah has imposed upon or legislated this act of giving wealth to others in order to purify yourselves. Tazkiyatun nafs. Look at the word tazkiyah, purification. Nafs of the soul. Tazkiyah is a derivative which is found from the word zakat. So zakat, when we said linguistically means purification, now we understand that to spend money or spend wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leads to the purification of the soul. How? By spending your hard-earned wealth on somebody other than yourself detaches you from the earth. Because man has got this tendency that as you earn and as you begin to collect an income and as you start to gather savings, you become attached to this dunya. You become attached to your wealth. Keeping in mind that the community and the economic system in which we live, as we saw a few nights back, we are under pressure to even seek wealth, even if it is at the expense of trampling on the rights of other people around us. Therefore, you find that the community in which we live is a community which is absolutely individualistic. The culture in which we live, the environment in which we live, it is so individualistic, it promotes consumption at the highest level, at every level of your life. Today, the world in which we live, everything is about consumption. You look at 99% of the billboards that we are exposed to. At the conscious and subconscious level, they are inviting you towards consumption. Look at the advertisements within the newspapers, if anybody buys hard copies of newspapers anymore. You look at through the newspapers that are printed. Look at the advertisements that are found within the newspaper. You could safely assume that 70 to 80% of the ads within the newspapers invite you towards consumption. Subhanallah, television and internet don't even begin. Perhaps if not 95%, but each and every one of them is inviting you towards consumption. فَإِنْتَ جَنَابَكْ, from the time you wake up to the time you sleep, without you being fully conscious about this or not, you are bombarded with messages that are inviting you towards consumption upon yourself. The idea of waking up in the morning and going to job and toiling day in, day out is such that you can have enough disposable income to consume. My goal behind the university education, to a certain extent, majority of the times, is that I can get a job which will allow me to consume. Very rarely, you can conduct, if you conduct a survey of university students or college students, conduct a survey and ask them, why are you within the university? What is your goal from this education? Majority of the times, it's about improving your standard of living, which isn't a sin, by the way, absolutely no. But we're trying to understand the mentality which dominates the culture in which we live to an extent that there is no boundaries when they come to consumption. For you conduct the survey within the university, why are most of the people studying? 90% of them will tell you to increase our standard of living, to become independent when we grow up. How many university students will tell you, I'm in the university to seek an education whereby I can make a difference to the world? Abadan la. Something that perhaps doesn't even exist. Therefore, we live in a community that dictates, that forces upon you, whether you like it or you don't like it, at a conscious level and at a subconscious level, it's inviting you towards consumption. Creating within us a nature of individualism, where consumption for myself is of utmost importance. How I consume, the amount that I consume, the income which I earn in order to consume, fi amanillah, as long as I consume, as long as I own things. And you find that this mentality is not a mentality that just happened to come up with the Industrial Revolution or within the 21st century as a result of technology and progress and development. La, this was a mentality that existed from the time, ever since time began. You see that this is within the nature of man, greed and this urge to consume and possess was a mentality that every Nabi, even prior to Rasulullah, tried to change within the community. So you find that even the Rasulullah tries to ingrain within the nature of the Muslims that as you live in an individualistic community that is bombarding you and leading you towards consumption and transforming you into individualists who think about no one but themselves, Islam will come and change you. No. Do not always think about yourself, but through the institution of Zakat, think about others. Just as you spend on yourselves, spend on others. Islam teaches us to invest in the collective good. Islam teaches us to care and to be worried about the plight, especially the economic plight of those who are around us. Life is not just about me. Islam came and said life is about us. And you find that this is where people whose motives clash with the principles of Islam, this is where now all hell breaks loose. But in any case, Islam comes and teaches us that no, you have a nature as a human being to be attached to your wealth. You have this nature to become greedy and to consume more than what is required and to consume perhaps at the expense of other people. Baba, sit back and spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, zakat, giving wealth in the way of Allah, regardless of whether it is from the obligatory division or the mustahab division, regardless of whether it is from the wajib division or mustahab division, this separating yourself from your wealth is an exercise where you practically, literally tell Allah, I am not a slave of the dunya. A human being cannot be a slave of God and also be the slave of his wealth. So then there needs to be a test, there needs to be an imtihan where you reinforce your loyalty and your submission to the Lord. You establish your relationship as a slave to the Lord and as not a slave to the dunya and a slave to your wealth. That imtihan is what? Spending in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Generic term zakat. Purification. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. For you find that the first philosophy behind the legislation of zakat is purification of the soul. Kad aflaha man zakkaha wa kad khaba man dassaha. Victorious is the one who purifies his nafs. And one of the ways of purifying the nafs is through paying zakat to detach your soul from hubbud dunya. Ahibba'i, this is actually tawheed amali. Yesterday, we were having a discussion, a very short discussion, but a discussion on tawheed. How do we experience tawheed at a practical level? You have tawheed amali. You sense the power and the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by purifying yourself from all evil traits, tazkiyatun nafs, by perfecting your akhlaq, and by separating your soul or your attachment of your soul from your wealth. For those of us who are seeking for that true tawheed, to feel the magnificence, to be aware of the presence, to sense the presence of Allah, in every aspect of our lives. This can only happen through implementing the seerah of Ahlul Bayt, and one of them is purification of the soul and detaching the soul from this love of the wealth, and automatically you find that you are surrounded by this aura and this level of spirituality where you can feel the presence of Allah. Many times we commit sins, why? Many times we are lax in our religion, why? Because we cannot sense. We're not fully convinced of that presence of Allah, if we may say. But this is something on its own. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. For you find that the first philosophy behind the establishment of the institution of zakat, purification of the soul. Number two, you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated the zakat in its generic terms, regardless of whether it is from the obligatory or from the mustahab, as a measure to combat poverty. This was an economic policy that was legislated by Allah to ensure that the Muslim ummah would not suffer from poverty. Islam as a religion does not only cater to our spiritual needs. La. Islam as a complete religion, way of life, gives us the best political system that we could think of. Islam gives us political lessons in terms of governance. It has given us rather the best model of governance. Islam has given us the best model of an economic system. Islam has given us the best social system in regards to family rules. Islam has even given us guidelines of what a prison system should be like. Ya subhanallah. For you find that spending in the way of Allah through khums and zakat was an economic policy implemented by Rasulullah upon the command of Allah to ensure that the Muslim ummah does not suffer from poverty. And then you find Imam al-Sadiq salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He comes forward and he makes a statement, she ajib jiddan, how true it is. The Imam comes on to say, لو أدوا الناس زكاة أموالهم لما بكي مسلم فقيرا محتاجا. If all the men were to pay their religious dues, whether it is khums or zakat, there would not remain a single poor Muslim on the face of this earth. Look at our state today. The reality, sometimes we need to be involved with major or global issues that are happening around us. And at the same time, we need to think of how we can be a positive solution to all the global problems that exist right now. Majority of the Muslim ummah is in a state of poverty. Look at the refugee crisis. The biggest proportion of refugees that live on this earth today are from the Muslim population. Greatest rates of poverty within Muslim countries. Subhanallah, that religion where the first verse to be revealed was Iqra, you find that majority of the illiteracy rates are within Muslim countries. Where are we and where is that Islam of Rasulullah? Where are we and where is that Islam of Ahlul Bayt? How did we get to the stage where we are, Ahibba'i, when we say that we are at a sorry state as a Muslim ummah? Because we abandoned Ahlul Bayt. And Sayyidah Fatima al-Zahra mentions this within her khutbah Fadakiyah. This is the crime that you are committing is going to have implications till the end of time. It's not that the Muslim world doesn't have wealthy people. How many schools of thought went on to discount the institution of Khums on its own? As a result of which, our Imam, Imam al-Sadiq, says that had the people paid from their wealth what is obligatory upon them, we would not have poverty within the Muslim ummah. And even in this day and age, because of the laxity and the lack of care and concern from individuals like those, even what we have and what we collect and spend in the homes, you will find that the amount of income coming in is way too little compared to the expenditures that are needed. Look at Iraq itself. How many million widows and orphans we have? Have we ever sat back and thought, who is there to support them? Financially, one side. How involved are we in the affairs of the ummah at a larger level? Do we even care about the plight of other Shias in the rest of the world or no? Or are we absorbed and sucked in by this individualistic, materialistic, consumption-based lifestyle such that my life revolves around me and my family and I do not care about everyone else? Are we aware of the plight of the Shias who are suffering in the world? The price that they are paying just because they are followers of Amir al-Mu'mineen? Do we shed tears for them? Do we feel their pain? Are we doing anything to relieve the burden from them? Where are we when it comes to activism? Where are we when it comes to politics? Where are we when it comes to journalism? Allahu Akbar. 2 years back, the greatest genocide to be committed inside of Iraq, the genocide of Camp Spiker, where over 1,700 Shia youth were slaughtered by like sheep by the Nawasib and people like ISIS. Who was there to cry with the widows, the mothers of these innocent youth? 1,700 of our youth by Tikrit. Half of them executed at close range and dumped into mass graves, half of them shot at point blank range on the banks of the river Dajla and their body thrown into the rivers. They say after this execution at Camp Spiker, the river banks of the Dajla was red in color. It's not something that happened in history. This is recent. Do we care? Are we concerned? Who is there to weep with the mother of this youth that has died, executed in this way? Aslan, do we even think about the trauma on that mother who has to claim the decapitated body of her son floating in a river? Their crime was what? They said, Ashhadu anna Aliya waliyullah. Do we care? Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. For you find that this institution of zakat symbolizes, is supposed to create within us a state where we are actively concerned for the greater good of humanity, for the greater good of our brothers and sisters in faith. Not only to be overcome by greed with individualistic consumption. Ya subhanallah, now you see that this institution of zakat and khums is not about giving a monetary amount of money. It represents something much greater. Now you understand why every Nabi and every Imam spoke about zakat and gave their lives, because it ingrains with us a culture. Rasulullah says, "Man asbaha wa la yahtam bi umur al-muslimin falaysa minna." The one who wakes up in the morning and is not concerned with the affairs of the Muslims is not from us. Killings of the Shia in Pakistan. وَالْعَجَبْ كُلُّ الْعَجَبْ. يعني the strangest of all strange things is that when you give a voice to these, to the oppression of these people, you get slingshot with accusations of sectarianism. It's become an excuse, a term that you use to hide the truth. Anyway, for you find that Zakat as an institution, a generic term, spending in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first philosophy behind that is to clean the heart and purify the soul from hubbud dunya, hubbul mal. Number two, it shows us that these are zakat, or spending in the way of Allah, the taxes that are legislated upon us, are active measures through which we are able to combat poverty within our communities. And the philosophies are many. I believe we are also running out of time, so I will move on. Tayyib. Then you come into khums. We established that khums will come under the generic term zakat. But still, for itmamul hujjah, to complete and to drive the argument home, we come forward. And the person might ask you, Ishkal, he says, ente, with all the importance that you pay in khums, is there any verse of the Quran that talks about khums, that says khums is wajib? As we've been saying over the last 8 nights or so, everything within our ideology needs burhan. Where is the burhan? From within the Quran, we say to them, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Quran and Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Suratul Anfal, verse number 41, وَإِعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا غَنِمْتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ فَأَنَّ لِلَّهِ خُمُسَهُ. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا غَنِمْتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ. Know, O Muslimin, that anything that you profit from, أَنَّمَا غَنِمْتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ, mutlak. In fact, if you go back to the linguists and the lexicons and look at the meaning of the word ghanima, which unfortunately a lot of mufassirin of the Quran who author the translations will inaccurately write gains of war. But if you go back to the Arabic lexicons, it just means gain, mutlak. It's not muqayyad, it is not restricted to gains of war only. La, any type of profit. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا غَنِمْتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ. If you profit from anything, فَأَنَّ لِلَّهِ خُمُسَهُ. Straight away from that saving, and all the details which is given to us from the hadith and from the books of fiqh, as per the teachings of Ahlul Bayt by our ulama, straight away from that saving, 1/5 of that is for Allah. وَلِذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَ وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ إِن كُنْتُمْ آمَنْتُمْ بِاللَّهِ. And then the verse goes on to say how this khums is divided into sahme sadat and sahme imam. Allah is saying that you will pay the khums only and only based on one condition. Based on what? In kuntum amantum billah. If you have iman in Allah, you will pay this khums. Allah. So you find that khums has to do with iman. In fact, since we are on this matter of khums, Imam al-Ridha, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, he states that, he says, innal khums awnan, innal khumsa awnuna ala deenina. He says, indeed, the payment of khums is a support system for our religion. The one who holds back his khums, in essence, is doing what? Weakening, destroying the support system of that religion which Imam Ridha says, I'm trying to establish. You look at the spendings of the khums. Maintaining the Hawza Ilmiya, maintaining tabligh, ensuring that the dhikr of Ahlul Bayt is there. All this is based on what? On that savings. And the word kalam over here is a lot. In any case, Then you come, you find within the Quran that the verse of Homs is absolutely established. Is there any proof from within the hadith of both ulama of the Shia and ulama of the Sunnah that people used to pay Homs during the lifetime of Rasulullah or no? Because unfortunately we have within our circles muta'assib. Person, you give them dalil from Imam Ridha and Amirul Mu'mineen? No, until we hear from Rasulullah, subhanallah. For you find that we have hadith that are mentioned both by ulama of the Ahl Shia and ulama of the Ahl Sunnah in regards to the legislation of Khums. I will read you one from Wasa'il al-Shia and one from Sahih Bukhari, subhanallah. Bala. First hadith from Wasa'il al-Shia, one of the greatest books of hadith, compilation of hadith that every one of our mujtahid has to depend on when it comes to ijtihad. Wasa'il al-Shia, hadith is mentioned by Rasulullah. Inna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. قال لأبي ذر والسلمان والمكداد. Rasulullah is talking and commanding who? Abu Dhar, Salman, Mikdad. أشهدوني على أنفسكم بشهادة لا إله إلا الله. I want you in front of me to bear witness that there is no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he made them bear witness in his risala and in the wilayah of Amirul Mu'mineen and. Hadith is long, I will go to the point that is important. He says that I want you to bear witness wa ikhrajul khums min kul ma yamlikuhu ahadan min an-nas hatta yarfa'ahu ila wali al-muslimin wa amirihim. I want you to bear witness that you are going to give the khums 1/5 of everything that you own. What we understand then from the rest of the hadith is Prophet, that you will pay this khums to the waliyul muslimin and to the amir of the muslimin. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa radhitu lakum al-islam adina. This verse was revealed when Rasulullah declared amirul mu'mineen as the imam. Man kuntum mawla fahada aliyum mawla. And then Umar ibn Khattab says, as per both narrations between the Ahl Shia and Ahl Sunnah, Bakhin Yabna Abi Talib, Asbahta Mawlaya wa Mawla Kulli Mu'minin wa Mu'mina. That you have now been declared as the Mawla, as the Amir of all Muslims. Therefore, that initial haq of Khums goes to who? To Amir al Mu'minin. Rasulullah says, and for after Amir al Mu'minin, the Ma'soom Imams after him. This is from our books. From Sahih Bukhari. He says, قَدَّمَ وَفْدُ عَبْدُ الْكَيْسِ قَدَّمَ وَفْدُ عَبْدِ الْكَيْسِ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. You see, 9 AH, which was the year of the Fath, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ الْفَتْحِ, when Makkah was conquered. That year is also known as عَامُ الْوُفُودِ. This is the year of the delegations. As all the surrounding tribes from in and around Hijaz, they were converting into Islam, they would come to sit with Rasulullah, they would come to visit Rasulullah, and they would take advice from him. One such tribe was the tribe of Abdul Qais. They came towards Rasulullah. Faqala, Rasulullah says to them, they are coming to meet Rasulullah for the first and only time, because Rasulullah is martyred the year after. One and only time, Ya Rasulullah, give us advice. Tayyib, what advice does Rasulullah give them? How does Rasulullah command them? Faqala, A'murukum bi arba'. I'm commanding you to abide by four things. From these four things, he says, wa ikama salat, to establish the prayer. Wa ita az-zakat, to pay the zakat. Now we find that Rasulullah makes a distinction between zakat and khums. Wa antu addu ilayyi, and that you send to me khums ma ghanimtum, everything that you profit through your business, knowing that this was an agricultural community or a community that had livestock. He says that whatever you profited in your trade, 1/5 of this you bring it back to me. Sahih Bukhari. For you find that khulasa, zakat, which is mentioned in the Quran, is a generic term that is used to denote spending wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes this wealth can be falls under two categories. Sometimes it is obligatory, wajib, and sometimes it is mustahab. From those that are wajib, one category is khums, and from those that are mustahab, what we have described. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. See, ahibai, giving wealth, whether it is obligatory or mustahab, giving charity is one thing. But the way you give charity is another thing altogether. And this is what Ahlul Bayt showed us. Sometimes we can give charity in a very arrogant way. Give the charity and make the other person feel humiliated. It is narrated that Imam al-Hussein, once a beggar comes to ask from him for wealth, the narration mentions Imam al-Hussein gave him the money from behind the curtain that was behind the door. The recipient of the donation begins to cry. Imam al-Hussein asks him in a very humble, low voice, "Oh man, why are you crying? Do you find that what I have given you is not sufficient?" He says to him, "No, I'm crying because of the way you give me this wealth." And that when Imam gives the wealth, he did not want to see the shyness or the shame of the recipient who has come to ask. Sometimes when a person comes to us and he's needy for wealth, the fact that he's raising his hand in front of us, he's needy, he's ashamed. But our Imam has so much haya and akhlaq. I do not want to see him become ashamed. So I will give him behind the curtain. On the Asr of Ashura, after Imam al-Hussein has been martyred, and with all the wounds that were on his body, like the way we said some nights back, 114 sword wounds, outside all the spears and the arrows and the stones that were thrown at him, his entire body covered in wounds. Shimmer comes to look at the body, Al-La'in. He says there are a number of wounds on the back of Imam al-Hussein that we cannot identify. These are not wounds that have been inflicted due to swords or spears or stones. What are these wounds? Nobody knows. They said, bring Sajjad, Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam. Bring him and ask him. You know, the narration mentions Imam Sajjad comes. He looks at the body of Imam al-Hussein. He begins to weep. He says, these are the bruises that my father incurred on his back due to the heavy sacks of wheat and rice which he would carry on his back while distributing them in charity to the poor people in Medina. Can you imagine the extent of bruises on the backs of our Imam? Sometimes it's not only about giving your money, it's about how you give that money. To give money to somebody to go and distribute it amongst poor people somewhere in the villages, war-torn areas is one thing, but for you to physically be there and endure that pain while you give that wealth is a different level of zakat altogether. Hence we bear. And the examples like these are many. Sometimes in charity we give away what we do not like, what we do not need, what we do not want. Look at the charity of Zayd al-Zahra, mother of Imam al-Hussein. Narration mentions on the night of her marriage, she's wearing her wedding dress. She has come, new wedding dress. She's in the door house of Amir al-Mu'mineen. A beggar knocks on the door. She does not have any clothing. Sayyida Zahra has two dresses in her house, the older dress and the newly stitched wedding dress. She wears or she puts on the old dress, dusty dress, and she gives her newly stitched wedding dress as charity. To give what you like, not to give what you don't like. There's a difference. These were our Ahlul Bayt. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. I realize I might have gone over in the majlis, so forgive me for this, but inshallah, we begin with the masa'ib of this youth of Karbala, the shining stars, moon, when the enemies described Imam Qasim or Shah Qasim when he walked into the battlefield. They say it is as if we saw the full moon has descended on Karbala. Allahu Akbar. The narration mentions, the Maqtal mentions that after the Salatul Dhuhr, as the time of Asr approached on the day of Ashura, and all of the companions of Imam al-Hussein had been martyred one after one, and then the Bani Hashim went into battle, as soon as the children from the lineage of Muslim bin Akil and the Sadat from the brothers of Abul Fadl al-Abbas and all the other Sadat from the family of Akil had become Shaheed, no one from the Bani Hashim had remained except the children of Imam al-Hassan. At this point, the narration mentions that Shah Qasim, who was 14 years of age, came out to Imam al-Hussein and he asked him, he said, "Oh my uncle, oh my master, I seek for permission to go into the battlefield." The narration mentions that when Qasim asked for permission from Rasulullah, from Imam al-Hussein, when Qasim asked permission from Imam al-Hussein, Imam al-Hussein looked at him and he said to him, "Oh Qasim, how can I grant you permission when you are the remainder of my brother Hassan? Allah, Allah. Oh Qasim, when I look at you, I remember Imam Hassan. How can I give you permission? You are the remainder of my brother. You are the sign of my brother." The narration mentions that Qasim was so insistent to go into the battlefield that he fell down to the ground. He would start kissing the feet of Imam al-Hussein. He would start kissing the hand of Imam al-Hussein. Every time Imam would refuse, the narration mentions that at one time Imam al-Hussein asks Qasim, he says, "Oh Qasim, but if you go into the battlefield, you are sure to be killed. How do you find death?" Qasim says, "Oh uncle, death in your way for me is sweeter than honey." The narration mentions that when Imam al-Hussein heard this, he hugged Qasim and Qasim hugged him and they wept until both of them fainted. Allahu Akbar. Imam al-Hussein refused to give permission to Qasim. Qasim was extremely distressed. The narration mentions he goes back to the tent and he begins to weep. At this time, his mother Ramla, or who is known amongst us as Farwa, she comes to Qasim. Qasim is crying. He says, "Oh my mother, my uncle Hussein will not give me permission to go into the battlefield." At this time, Sayyida Farwa gives a letter to Qasim. She says, "Oh my son Qasim, when your father was passed away, when your father was martyred, he gave me a wasiyah that is to be opened on a day like Karbala. To open this, this is for you." Qasim says that I opened the letter and I saw that this is a letter from my father. It says, "Assalamu alayka ya bunayya ya Qasim. Peace be upon you, my son Qasim. When you find yourself in Karbala and your uncle is surrounded by enemies, do not hesitate to go and fight in the battlefield and do not hesitate to sacrifice your soul for him. For indeed you will represent me on that day." Allah, Allah, Qasim is the representative of Imam Hassan in Karbala. As soon as he saw this letter, the Maqtal mentions he stood up with joy. He went running towards Imam al-Hussein and he gave him the letter. When Imam al-Hussein saw this letter, tears began to stream down his cheeks. He said, "This is the wasiyah of my brother." The narration mentions that Imam Hussein took Qasim into the Khaymaga, into the tent. Allahu Akbar. And from within the tent, Imam al-Hussein removed a sanduq. He removed like a type of a chest. He opened the chest. From inside this chest, he removed the amama of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. And he removed the kaba. The narration mentions he split the cloth of the amama into half because Qasim was a young boy of 14. Imam al-Hussein tied the amama of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba around the head of Qasim. He made him wear the kaba of Imam al-Hassan and he tied it in such a way that it looked like a coffin. Imam al-Hussein then told Qasim, go and bid farewell to your mother and to your auntie Zainab. The narration mentions that when Qasim went into the khaymah of the women, Sayyida Zainab, when she looked at Qasim wearing the amama of Imam al-Hassan, she stood up and she said, is this my brother Hassan? Allah, Allah! She says, oh Qasim, yesterday I saw your brother vomiting pieces of his liver into a tusht, and today I'm going to see you being killed on a battlefield. Qasim bids all the women farewell. He bids his mother farewell. The narration mentions Qasim, being the age of 14, did not enter into the Maidan on a horse. He comes into the Maidan on his feet. The narration mentions that he came into the battlefield despite being the age of 14. He walked into the battlefield with courage. He pointed his sword towards Umar ibn Sa'ad and then he rebuked him. He said, oh man, this is my uncle Hussein, the grandson of Rasulullah, under siege. You impose thirst on their children and you call yourself from amongst the Muslims of Islam. Indeed, you are one of the most evil people on the face of this earth. The narration mentions Qasim went into the Maidan, the grandson of Amir al-Mu'mineen Haydar al-Karrar. He performed the jihad, which is a jihad of Haydar. The narration mentions he killed 70 of the enemies while he was reciting a poem. As he killed them, he would say to them, in tunkiruni fa ana najlul hasan sibtun nabiy al-mustafa al-murta سبت النبي المصطفى والمؤتمن هذا حسين كالأسير المرتهن بين أناس لا سكو صوب المذب. Imam Qasim would say to them, if you don't know who I am the son of Hassan, the son of Rasulullah. This is Hussein who is under siege like a prisoner. This is Hussein under siege like a prisoner amongst men who are evil. The narration mentions that he killed 70 of the enemies when none of them were able to counter him. The Umar ibn Sa'ad gave a command. He said, Amtiruhum bil hijara. Hamid ibn Muslim says, Fa'amtaru alayhim al hijara wa hum yakulun. Hada khariji wa abnul khariji. When they were not able to stand in front of Qasim, they began throwing stones on Qasim from every direction, saying that this is the enemy of God, and his father Hassan was also the enemy of God. Allah, Allah! The Maktal mentions, as they threw stones on him, Qasim returned back. When Qasim stood back and they stopped throwing stones, Qasim looked around. The Maktal mentions that his body had 35 wounds on him. As he stood on the Maidan, he noticed that the lace of his sandal was broken. Qasim bent down to tie his lace as if to show these enemies, regardless of who you are, you do not mean anything to me. As Qasim was tying his lace, one of the La'in by the name of Amr ibn Sa'ad, Amr ibn Sa'id al-Asadi, says to Habib ibn Muslim, Wallah, I will kill this child. Habib ibn Muslim says to him, but look at the innocence of his face. The narration mentions as Qasim was tying his shoeless, he stood up. The Zalim came from behind. فَذَرَبَهُ بِسَيْفِهِ عَلَى رَأْسِهِ. He came and he struck Qasim on the head with a sword. Allah, Allah, ya zalim, you didn't even attack Qasim from in front, you attacked him from behind. The narration mentions the strike was such, فَوَكَعَ Qasim عَلَى وَجْهِ. The strike was so powerful, Qasim fell down on his face. Ha, 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 ha. mentions the strike was so hard. Qasim fell on his face. Blood is pouring down his face and blood is pouring down his back. At this time he cried out, Adrikni ya Amma! Oh my uncle Hussein, help me! As soon as Imam al-Hussein heard the cry of Qasim, the narration mentions, Fakharaja wa darabahum kallaythil ghadban. Imam al-Hussein attacked the enemies like a raging lion. But within this confusion, the enemies began running in every direction. One of the narration mentions that as the horses were retreating, they trampled on the body of Qasim. Hamid ibn Muslim says that as all this confusion was happening, the dust covered the air. We couldn't see what is happening. But when the dust settled, he says, Wa idha al-Hussein bi ghulamin wa huwa yafusu rijlay. He says, when the dust settled, we saw Imam al-Hussein sitting by the head of a young boy who was moving his legs up and down due to the pain. Imam al-Hussein sat and put the head of Qasim on his lap and he said, Wallah azza ala ammika, wallahi azza ala ammika an tad'uhu fala yanfa'ak fala yujibak aw yujibuka fala yanfa'ak. He says, Wallah, O Qasim, it is hard on your uncle that you called him for help but he was not able to do anything, or that when he came to you he's not able to help you. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. The narration mentions when Qasim took his final breath, Imam al-Hussein tried to carry Qasim. He put his chest on the chest of Qasim, walking towards the Khaymaqa as the legs of Qasim were dragging on the sands of Karbala. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Matame Hussein, ya Hussein.